Joe Fontana, it's that time. It's Mayor Monday. And this is a different format today, everyone. Today, I have great, great guests. And they're from the governor's office. So what I'm going to do is we're going to have an open dialogue. I get to ask them questions. And basically, some of these questions relate to the recent visit that our great governor came to Fontana to introduce a new plan that they will be talking to us about. So to start us off, I'd like to introduce Molly Wiltshire, who is in external affairs for the state of California for the governor's office. Molly, please tell us who your friends are.
Well, thank you, Mayor. We're really happy to be joining you today and happy to be here again in Fontana. I'm Molly Wiltshire. I serve as the Chief Deputy and SoCal Regional Director of External Affairs for the Governor, based right here in the Inland Empire. And I'm joined by my colleague, Karina. So I'd love to have her introduce herself.
Good morning, Mayor Warren, and good morning, Fontana. Thank you so much for having us today. I'm Karina Tamaya. I'm the SoCal Regional Coordinator of External Affairs for Governor Newsom's office as well. And I also serve out of the Inland Empire office in downtown Riverside. Thank you so much for having us.
Welcome.
And then, Mayor, it's our great honor to really be joined here today with by Dr. Erica Pahn. Dr. Pahn serves as the Deputy Director of the Center for Infectious Diseases and our state epidemiologist. Just happy I could say all those words with the California Department of Public Health. Dr. Pahn has also served as the acting state public health officer for us since August 10th, 2020. So right in the midst of the pandemic beginning. And Dr. Pahn has received her MD and her MPH degrees from Tufts University School of Medicine and completed her undergraduate degree at Stanford University. So Dr. Pahn, we're really thankful and grateful to have you here today.
Oh, thank you. It's such an honor to be here with you all. Thank you.
I can't tell all of you what an honor it is to have all of you here. You know, I have to mention it because Mayor Monday, during the months that we are doing our Mayor Mondays, we talk about the larger holidays, celebrations, and it happens to be Women's History Month. And that's big in our town because women know what they're doing. Sorry, guys, you know what you're doing too, but it's our month. And to have all these great women here, and Dr. Pahn, I gotta tell you, when the governor came out, it just gave so much hope to everyone because we've all seen what this COVID virus thing has done to the communities. And everyone's excited about coming out of this. And I think we learned a lot and we want to do it better. And that's why I'm so glad you're joining us. When the governor visited us, he talked about a smarter plan. Which one of you would like to address that?
Well, I'd be happy to just maybe say a few comments, but I really would love to pass it over to Dr. Pahn, who's the expert and one of the chief architects of the plan. You know, we thank you, Mayor, as well. Be remiss if we didn't thank you for hosting us just last month. Dr. Pahn was with us, with the governor in the city of Fontana to unveil this plan. And really, this plan builds upon lessons learned over the last 2 years and builds upon the state's commitment to equity. And the SMARTER plan focuses on, you know, continued readiness, awareness, and really flexibility to guide California's pandemic response while moving the state's recovery forward. And so I'd love to turn it over to Dr. Pahn to talk a little bit more about that, including what that SMARTER acronym stands for.
Sure, I'm happy to. And I think part of this is, and one of just the last thing about my background is I did start out at the local level. So actually in the beginning of the pandemic was a county health officer and have moved to the state. So I know what it's like to be on the ground and on the front lines like you are. And again, appreciate the opportunity to talk to you. So we've come so far since that time. You know, it's been over 2 years now since this pandemic started. And what the SMARTER plan does is really help set us up to use everything we've learned and be ready for the next surge, if we have another surge of COVID and all that. So the acronym SMARTER has many important things about the tools we've used and we will continue to use. So shots are vaccines, right? So we know vaccines are really one of our most important tools to get immunity and have longer lasting immunity and really get us through to the other side to really keep moving forward. So we really need to close gaps on vaccinations, continue to get more trust. So that's what shots are. Masks. So we know that well-fitted, well-filtered masks can protect us from this virus, especially in higher risk settings or for people who are medical conditions or might have other immune system problems. Wearing masks when recommended or required are really important to help as a tool when we need it during surges or other important times during this pandemic. And then A is for awareness. So that is a lot of my job as an epidemiologist, is to monitor the data, do great surveillance, and continue to improve and build upon the surveillance we've done throughout this. So things like, looking at wastewater, so it's not dependent on people going to get a test. We can really look at that and see early detection, improving our surveillance with hospitals and other things like that. So that's awareness. And then readiness is being prepared. So making sure we have, contracts set up so we can surge if needed, if our hospitals need more healthcare workers. We all know it's been really hard on our healthcare workers through this pandemic and a lot of burnout and fatigue. So being ready and prepared to provide support in those areas, make sure we can stand up more testing when needed, those kinds of things. Harkening back to early in 2020, we could barely get, a few tests even in the hospital, and now we have millions. So we want to maintain that capability. There's some shifting of testing from, the PCR that takes a little longer to the antigen testing. There's more and more over-the-counter at-home testing and kits, so wanting to make sure those are available for Californians. And then E is education. So what is more important than our kids and our schools, right? As a parent myself too, like we all know, we want our kids to be in school and as safe as possible and continuing to have that balance and providing all these tools in that school setting. So lots of resources still going to schools to make sure that can happen. And then R is actually kind of for the RX for treatment. So that's the other thing that's evolving that is so great about getting us out of this pandemic. There's more and more treatments that are becoming available, more pills or oral antivirals that are effective. And those seem to be more stable against the new variants that are coming through. There have been some other IV medicines, things called antibodies, monoclonal antibodies, or there's another antiviral medicine that's only IV. Those are antibodies are a little more sensitive when there's new variants, but these oral medications, again, we're hoping there continue to be more of them and more availability. So that's something we really wanna make sure. And I think with an eye to equity, making sure we can get medicines to people as soon as possible, sort of in the community, including those who are uninsured or don't have a medical home.
I thank you for that. We're going to actually do a similar campaign, pushing this information out to our great public, your plan, because we want everyone to have access to what is available today. But speaking of today, one of the things that highlighted that conference we had with the governor when he came up with a press conference, California is the first managing our way out of this. How does that all come together?
Yeah, I think as you are mentioning, we were the first to come out with this plan and really outline all these key components, key tools that we've learned a lot about. We know how to use them, how to use our awareness to then moderate when we say masks are needed or not, all of these things. So we were kind of the first to really talk about this in a different way and try to move all of us out of kind of emergency response to like, how do we just learn to incorporate this and be ready for the next that this virus continues to challenge us, but we're ready for the challenge.
It shows too. I tell you, now this is one of those questions that I get from a lot of young people. What is our new normal going to look like?
Yeah, such a great question. And I've learned to try not to have I don't have a crystal ball and not pretend that I do. But I think, what we hope to get to is when this virus is not disrupting our daily lives, right? In the middle of the Omicron surge, we couldn't even staff our, not only our hospitals, but our, all of our other infrastructure. So we really want to get to a place where we have enough of these tools that we're not impacting our infrastructure, our daily lives. Part of the new normal might be like every winter, we might just pull out. These masks actually help, you know, we haven't seen much flu in the last 2 years. And a lot of people think that's from not only decreased contact between people, but wearing masks. So, you know, there are other countries that, you know, use masks a lot more. And we do think this might be part of, you know, sometimes in my field, we call it respiratory etiquette, where we say, cover your cough with your elbow, you know, instead of your hand. So this would be part of like, wear a mask, especially if you have a mild sniffle, just put that mask on and it'll help, you know, prevent you from getting anyone else infected. And going to the store in the winter, you might want to just put your mask on to help protect you. So I think those are the kinds of things that might be the new normal. We might be continuing to use tests quite a bit, you know, before going into certain events. Or for me, I still kind of test my kids before we go visit my elderly parents. I just want to protect them. So things like that are part of our new normal, I think.
You know, it sounds like it's consideration for others. Maybe you can incorporate that in. Remember, that came from the mayor of Fontana. We'll teach people how to be considerate. When I go to see my elderly relatives, I wear my mask. I feel more comfortable for them and they feel more comfortable opening up the door. And we've all got to do that. We've just got to do it. You know, one of the things that has kind of troubled people is the variants keep coming out. I'm very comfortable that we're prepared, but what is your take on these various variants?
Yeah, wonderful question. And I think this virus does continue to change quite quickly. So we will and are seeing new variants or minor, you know, and sometimes there's a minor difference. And then what happens when we have a new Greek letter, for example, it's when there's a more major difference. So that's part of this awareness, making sure, again, we have this surveillance. We're doing more and more what we call whole genome sequencing, which is like looking at a fingerprint of the strain of the virus and trying to determine what not only is the variant and what does that mean about, you know, how much immunity you might have from vaccination, how well the treatments work, all of those things. So I think, again, the SMARTER plan is helping us adapt to that and be ready for that next one. And what we don't know, I can say I think there will be new variants, but I can't tell you whether they'll be milder, which is what we hope, or could there be another one that is more serious, but maybe we have strong immunity too. So there's lots of variations of that.
You know, the openness of all of the conversations everyone is having, it's such a change from the past, you know, before this COVID theory hit. People talk to each other now and they share information. And whoever thought washing your hands and covering your mouth would ever become so important. But as a city, we want to get the word out. We want to assist your efforts. And so how are you supporting cities? Because we want to hear more from the state. Those press conferences that came on at noon with the governor speaking with all of the experts, I didn't miss them. And a lot of people didn't, because we wanted to hear what we could do to help. So how can we get support from the state so that we can push the plan out? I'm thinking about magnets to go on the refrigerator, but, you know, pot holders, something.
Well, one thing I know we have, I'm trying to see if I have one handy, is a little pamphlet. Oh yeah, here's one example of, if it'll show, oh, it won't show up in my, anyway, we'll send out later, but we have a little practical ABCs for Californians related to the SMARTER plan. So that's something to get out. I think we're doing a lot of messaging and campaigning around all of these elements of the SMARTER plan, especially again, continuing to get vaccines and boosters and increasing those numbers. The other thing we do from the public health side is we meet weekly, at least weekly, with our local public health departments. And they, in turn, I think also, you know, work closely with local leaders like yourself to make sure they're providing updates to others in their local communities, and they can adapt their message to what they're doing locally and kind of incorporate all of that.
Well, this particular episode goes far beyond Fontana. So don't be surprised, Molly, if you don't get, and Karina, you don't start getting all these needs for you to come on and talk to other people. But I got to tell you, I loved when the governor spoke to us about how we have to be humble, how we have to be prepared, and how we have to be patient. What are your thoughts? I'd like to hear from all of you on that. You're right there with this campaign.
I can start and then I'll turn it over to Molly. I think, you know, absolutely, we want people to be humble and respectful and have, even before with flu, I would tell people, you need to have a healthy respect for these viruses. I mean, my world is viruses and infections, so I think about them a lot more than everyone else. But I think, you know, you need to have this healthy respect for it. And and also be ready for change. I think if there's one thing we've learned, it's adaptability. We have to continue to learn and be humble and continue to get better. And I think we would ask our communities to be patient with that too, just to know that, you know, sometimes our direction changes, and that's because this virus and this pandemic has been changing. So I'll turn it over to my colleagues.
You know, that was a great explanation. Maybe we just want Karina to speak. Come on, Karina, say something.
Go ahead, Karina.
Thank you, Mayor Warren. And thank you to Dr. Pond for really being our expert and leading us in this conversation. But you know, echo everything that Dr. Pond has shared today and the words that the governor explained when he came to Fontana around the COVID-19 and the surges that, you know, we've seen in the past and how we've prepared these past 2 years. And I think continuing to build on the great work that our state and our local leaders like yourself have been doing, I think that's going to be what's going to keep us moving forward and what's going to keep all of us protected, as well as our most vulnerable community members, which are our immunocompromised and as well as our children. So I think continuing to build on that will definitely continue to take us forward and keep us moving in the right direction.
Outstanding.
And I'd say, you know, the last 2 years have been so hard, so challenging. And despite all of that, we saw community come together in ways that were just unimaginable. And so I'd just like to thank the community for all of that they've done, Mayor, for what you've done on your continued leadership to make sure residents had information, access to testing, vaccinations, and other resources. You know, as a state, we were able to really ramp up and relied heavily on our community-based organizations, on our faith-based organizations as trusted messengers to really those who are from the community who understand their unique needs and understand where they're coming from. And they just did a phenomenal job in helping us to get to the place where we're at. And we know we're going to need them moving forward. And so we're all in this together. And I think the governor has tried to continue to make that message known that, you know, we know COVID's not going away. As Dr. Pond mentioned, you know, we're learning to live with it and to make sure we're ready. So, you know, the fatigue was real. You know, everyone was tired of being cooped up in their homes, and we're happy that we're able to get out more. And I think, you know, continuing to practice these measures, whether that's your mask, getting your, you know, taking a test, and continuing on the vaccinations. You know, we know that's ever changing in terms of what boosters are going to look like moving forward. And so, you know, just always encourage, you know, community members who haven't gotten their vaccine yet that they can do so. They're free. You know, there's many places to get them. We still have our covid19.ca.gov website. That is a great resource that Dr. Pond and her team have helped put together to help community access that information. But we're in this together, and we're proud of the work that we've done so far. We know what we don't know in the challenges that are coming ahead, but I think we are very prepared to meet those, you know, and we will. And so we're excited for what the future holds.
This is incredible. I can't thank all of you enough for joining me this morning. I think Mayor Mundy's are for information, and you have all assisted me in getting that information out to our great public. We're going to get some of those pamphlets, and we're going to be passing them out at all of our events. We do Fontana Walks. We have all of our community services. We have our council meetings. Wherever they are, we're going to pass that information. We're going to also show on this show the website for a smarter plan. And I'm going to see, can I get our Mayor's Youth Advisory Board involved with this and making sure that we get this information out to our teens and our youth, because they're our future and we need them to be humble, prepared, and patient. So thank you all for joining me today. And in Mayor Mundy, we always remind everyone, everybody. I didn't hear you all out there. Okay, let me help you with this. To move this great town forward, we have to be together. So thank you for joining me.